morning, everybody. Will you stand with us as we enter into a time of worship? We're so glad that you're here, that you're joining us on this cold January morning.
Because creation. There at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And as you speak, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. Speak in vain, no syllable empty or void. For once you have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak, to die. that as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. When you lost your life so I could find it here, if you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart, everything you've done, every part designed in a work of art called if you gladly chose surrender, so will I. I can see your heart 8 billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. If you gave your life to love them, so
thank you.
I woke up and I was just praying and praying for all of you and what I was going to say and all those good things. And before I even realized what the order of songs was going to be, I knew that during this time I wanted to encourage those of you. I felt very strongly that there's some of you who have been holding on to a word, a promise that has not yet been fulfilled. Or also that you're just like, I've thrown up a Hail Mary to God and I've been waiting for a response and I have not felt like I know. Maybe you feel directionless. Maybe you feel overwhelmed. Maybe you are feeling the effects of this dreary weather and you're feeling depressed and having anxiety. All those things God cares about. Amen. He cares about you. And he cares about you so much that you are here today and you are surrounded by people who love you and want to encourage you. So I'm going to encourage you during this time, if any of those categories, that was a lot of categories, if you fit into any of them, I'm going to encourage you to come and pray with somebody, because there's strength in numbers, right? When you feel discouraged, you typically go talk to a friend, right? I do. If I need encouragement, I go and find my besties. And I vent, I will talk it out. I'll do whatever I need to do. I cry it out with them because I know that they care about me. And I promise you that this ministry team, they've been praying for you all week and they care about you. And God cares about you. So at this time, if you want to come forward while we're singing this, I encourage you to do so. Let the Holy Spirit minister to your heart this morning.
Good. Oh, you
just good when everything is lined up. He's good in the hard times. He's good in the really, really trying times. He's good because he stays the same. We shift and change, but he is steady, and he is who he says he is. He has been faithful all these years. When we talked about the song right before the So Will I, like when we declare about creation, that he is a God that created everything. He created you with intentionality and with purpose, and he cares about every fine detail about your life. If we can believe that everything was intricately designed, then don't for a second believe that you were not intricately designed by a God who sees you. He's a God who knows you. So let's declare that one more time before we just end this time of worship, that he is good. And sing it over your own heart, your own mind. Remind yourself of truth today as you sing these words, that you are good. God, I pray that you will make yourself known to their hearts, that they will know that they are not alone, that they can do hard things. And God, I just pray that this depression will lift in the name of Jesus, that despite the weather, despite lack of vitamin D and all those things, I pray that depression will cease in the name of Jesus. Because you're a God who knows us, and you know a God, you're a God who knows what our hearts need. And so today I just lift up those who are walking through that. God, I just feel it very strong today. And I pray that they will speak and find that there's friends and that there's people who want to hear from them, and that they are not unimportant or unseen, but they are very much valued. And we value them as individuals and here at Genesis Church. And so I just lift those up, the people today who need to just have that special touch from you. And God, anybody else who has been holding on to a promise or a word, or that's just becoming weary in holding on to that, I pray that you will just ignite a spark to the embers of their hearts, God. That they will remind themselves of truth even in the unknown today. We thank you, God, that you are a God that we can come so freely to, so openly to. And I just pray that today our hearts will be in tune with you, Holy Spirit, as we receive your word, as we hear from you. God, I just pray that you will continue to work upon our hearts, to align us with the heart that you have for others and for ourselves. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. If you would just take a moment and just greet one another. We're so glad that you're here. If you haven't seen somebody in a while, say hey. Maybe if you don't know somebody, say hi and introduce yourself. Hello, hello again. I'm so glad that you guys are here. Students, we welcome you back. We hope that you had a great time at SALT. We can't wait to hear about it. And we know that you were ministered to while you were away. And we missed you when you were away. Before we move any further, I just want to take a moment and just highlight our giving. This is for those who are our regular attenders. If you are here with us and you call Genesis home, this is a time for you to give. We really believe that giving is the act of worship, not just singing songs, and it's an act of surrender. And one of the hardest things to surrender is finances, and we all can agree to that. I know that sometimes we want to be a little, I just lost my train of thought. I looked at all you, and you got a haircut. You're all distracting me. Sorry, y'all. But that giving is a reflection of our hearts, right? The Bible tells us that where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And so we believe that giving is a reflector of that. If you look in the mirror, if you want to see what kind of person you are, look at how you give and how you serve others. And that will show you a great deal where your heart is and where it's aligned. And so with that being said, I would love to encourage you to give today. There's three different ways you can give online. If you're at home, you just follow igenesischurch.com/give and follow the prompts there. There's a giving station in the back. And if you would like to give by mail, there's our address up there as well. And so will you just take a moment? Let's just pray and thank God for his faithfulness in our finances. Jesus, we thank you that you are good and that you have provided so much for us, that even jobs and different ways that we come into wealth, God, I thank you that you are a provider, God, and that you provide all things. God, I thank you that throughout my whole life, God, that you have shown yourself true, that you have never let me down, God. Whenever I've needed it most, God, when I needed things and were desperate, God, and times whenever I could have abundance and give generously, I thank you for those seasons of life, God. And I just pray today that you will bless this offering. God, use it to further your kingdom here in Bloomington and across the world, God, as we support our missionaries, God. And I just thank you for everybody who gives. I pray that you will just show up in their lives in abundant ways, God. I pray that you will be an abundant God today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So if you are new with us, I want to say, hey, I didn't introduce myself. My name's Darcy. I am on staff here, and I'm also married to EJ, who's the lead pastor. And so we're so glad that you are here today. And if there's, if you could just take a moment and text the word new to the number 812-393-1410, we would love to just send you a Chick-fil-A gift card, just as our way of saying thanks for being here. We would love to keep in touch and let you know what's going on here at Genesis. There's always things going on, and we're so grateful that we are a church that doesn't just come on Sunday mornings, but that we live life together and we do things together and we also serve together. There's great opportunities here. So if you want to just fill that, you have to not just, blah, 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 I'm like a hot mess today. If you can just type new, but then also follow the prompts with the Connect card on there and fill that out, then we will send you that gift card right away as our way of saying thanks. If you're a guy in this room, will you raise your hand? Let me see you.
Dudes, let me hear you roar.
I don't know. It's kind of weird coming from me. I do have four boys, so I hype them up often, okay? So this announcement is for you. And ladies, if you're married to a guy, this announcement's for you because you got to let them come and you got to let them hang out for Brotherhood, which is a game night coming up on January 26th. Everybody say January 26th. That's coming up sooner than later. It's on a Friday night at 6:30. It's going to be here at Genesis in the youth room. There will be lots of pizza, wings, and a night of games, just hanging out, getting to know each other. This is a great time just to come and just be, right, and have fun. And it's actually this Friday, which is crazy that the 26th is this Friday. It does cost $10, and it will cover all the expenses for the night. So if you just want to bring your money, if you want to sponsor somebody, if you're like, hey, I got an extra $10, I'd love to sponsor somebody, let us know. We want everybody to be able to attend. So guys, that's for you Friday night. Where are you going to be?
Here.
I don't know. I only hear EJ's booming voice. He's like, roar. Okay, so also today, everybody say today. If you serve in any capacity here at Genesis Church, right, we want to say thank you to our dream team. This is our way of saying thank you to you from staff, to you guys who serve and volunteer of your time and your energy and your resources and your time, everything. And so there is a party right after church. Now, this is for those who regularly attend, volunteer, and it's right after service. It's going to be in the youth room where we're going to serve you. We're going to have some pasta, and we're going to have an Italian theme party. And so this is just our way of saying thanks to you for serving. If you didn't RSVP, that's okay. Please come anyways. We would love to have you there. And then our last announcement today, this is one that's really important. If you are a partner here, if that's if you're somebody who in other times it's called a member, if you're a partner member, this is for you. We're having our annual vision meeting, which is the time where we set aside once a year to kind of go over all the logistics of the church, but also for all of the vision that we have for Genesis in this upcoming year and for the future. And so this is, we've kind of taken into account in the past, it's been done right after church, and we know that that can be hard sometimes because you're hungry and people have things to do. And so this year, it's actually going to be on Wednesday, February 7th at 6:30. So there will be no kids classes that night, but childcare will be provided. But this is our official partners meeting. And we ask you that if you are one of the partners here at Genesis, we encourage you strongly, not just like, I hope you come, like I need you here kind of coming, right? Because we are going to be unveiling a lot of the future plans for Genesis and what's going on. And also just to talk about what's been going on this past year. And so sometimes you have questions. This is the time to get your answers. And so February 7th, so Wednesday night at 6:30. There's also packets that all the business reports from all the ministry leaders are in a packet at the Welcome Center. That's for you to take home, to read over, take notes, get your questions ready, whatever you need to do. That's for you. It's provided for you so that everything's out in the open for you to see. So with that being said, will you all welcome Pastor EJ up?
Oh, good morning. thank you for that. I'm excited that you guys are back, students, and I'm glad that we're all here together today. We've been in this series called Bless All Nations, and would you open in your Bibles with me to the very beginning of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1. If you've never read the Bible, this is your day to like get it real easy. Right? We're not telling you some random things. You don't need to go to the table of contents. You can just open to the first page of your Bible, Genesis chapter 1. You can stick your finger there. Each week of this series, we've really been building upon the last week, and we've done that intentionally. You know, we've talked about how God has called us to reach all the nations and to play our part where we are to bless all nations, that's been God's heart from the beginning, that he wants to bless the world, that he wants people to know him. He wants all the world to come to know him and who he is through saving faith in Jesus, through putting our trust in him, our allegiance in him. That's what God wants to do. And he doesn't just choose to force that upon us, but rather he wants to co-labor with us. He chooses to use those who say yes to following him and use us to be part of that, to be part of the blessing of the world. And instead of being this whole big vision thing that we have no idea how we're going to do it, how do I play a role in blessing all the nations of the world, all these different nations? I mean, we have the Olympics coming up, and when they do the Parade of Nations, like, it's really cool for the first 5 minutes, and then you're like, my gosh, this takes forever, doesn't it, right? All the nations of the world. How do I, myself, and my job, and my, how do I play a part? And so last week we talked about how each and every one of us is anointed. That anointing is not something reserved for super spiritual people. It's not just reserved for the really committed Christians or what. We are all anointed because when you say yes to Jesus, he puts his Holy Spirit on the inside of you, and it's the Spirit that carries the anointing. And so the same anointing Jesus had when he stood up in Luke chapter 4 and said, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me and he's anointed me, that same anointing is in each and every one of us. And that anointing was for this mission to bless all nations. So that's a quick recap of where we've been. Today, I want to talk about how we go about that. It's one thing to say, go out there, save the world, save the nations, right? Go out there, do your part. Right where you're at, like get involved, go do it. It's another thing, though, to walk about or to talk about how we go about doing that. So that's what I really want to get at today. I want to talk about one aspect of how we can align our lives with God's mission. And I want to talk about something that you might not expect. I want to talk about our work today. The work of our hands, what we do, your job, but also everything else. I want to talk about our work. In a study last year by the American Institute of Stress, says that 62% of employees have high levels of stress paired with extreme fatigue and feelings of being out of control of their situations. 59% see accomplishing only basic responsibilities as the most important thing that they're committed to at their workplace, more than being present, more than working with excellence, more than personal growth. They just see getting just the basics of my job done. That's what's most important. 1 in 4 felt like screaming or shouting because their job stress was overwhelming. 1 in 5 experienced some sort of threat or verbal intimidation at work this past year. 42% said that yelling and verbal abuse is common in the workplace. And a whopping 76% said that workplace stress negatively impacts their personal relationships. That's crazy. It goes a little bit deeper. It's reported that 60% are emotionally detached while at work, and that 1 in 5 are actually miserable at their workplace. 9 out of 10 people say that they're not working their dream job, the job that they want to work, the job that they had hoped for, that they had strived for. And 7 out of 10 said that they've just plain given up on working that dream job. Now, if we're coming at this with the premise that God actually cares about our work and he wants to use our work as part of his mission, then these are some big challenges that we have to face, that we have to deal with. But there's some good news. It's also reported that 70% of people believe that it is important that companies make the world a better place. The people we work for, there's this belief, 70% of us believe that the place we work should be contributing to making the world a better place. 41% of millennial investors reported that they care if a company is committed to making the world a better place before they'll invest their finances. 55% believe that companies should take a stand on key social, environmental, and political issues. And 9 out of 10 people even went as far as saying they're willing to take a pay cut to do more meaningful work. The average was willing to take a 23% pay cut if it meant the work they did would be meaningful. So although work can trigger a lot of issues for us, how many of you have ever had a moment at work, right, and you're like, dear Lord, you need to help me because the spirit of slap's coming upon me, right? Like, I saw a hand go right up, like, me. even though it can trigger us and we can have those moments, we also desperately want our work and we want our lives to be meaningful and have a purpose. Like, that is also such a deep part of us. And we have these two conflicting desires and emotions on the inside of us when it comes to the work of our hands. If you think about it, you spend a third of your life working a job, but our work is also not just the job that we work, it's also our personal work. It's the tasks that you complete and you check off your list every day. It's projects, it's cleaning your house, it's raising your kids, it's budgeting, it's repairing your home and your car, it's helping other people, helping your neighbors, and so on. I mean, it's the work of your hands, and that's over a third of your life that typically we don't think God has any part of, unless we're being intentional about it. Some people have dreams of creating enough passive income so that they can stop working, so that they don't have to work. Some see retirement as crossing that finish line of a lifetime of hard work, and now I get the real good part of life where I don't do any work. Others see their job as just the means to an end to provide a certain lifestyle for themselves and their family, but that's the only value that their work has. Still others, they drag themselves out of bed every morning, dreading their day and just trying to make it through to the weekend. When I was growing up, we had TGIF on TV. Anybody remember what that? Thank God it's Friday. And then Friday was when the best shows were on. It was like, weekend is here. It's like, it's my time. Like, my boss better not call me. Like, that's how it was growing up. Like, it was just make it through the week, get to the weekend, and then I don't have to work and life is good. Some of these things that we were just talking about, they can be good. They speak to good stewardship, while others are saddened. We know they're saddened, but we don't really know how to deal with it. We don't know how to fix it. It's just a sad thing, sad reality. But are these really the ultimate goals of our work? Is this really what life, is this that third of our life? Is that what it's all about? Are these emotions and these tensions and these feelings and the insignificance and meaninglessness that can come along with it? I can't help but think that it's very easy to develop a negative attitude towards our work, as if work is the enemy and no work is the dream, or that's the good life. The problem, though, and it's a big problem, is that work is actually an innate part of our creation. It's something that God instilled in us when he created us. God created us to work. He didn't create us to be his slaves that would do his bidding at the crack of his whip. God didn't create us like that. God created us to co-labor with him, to contribute to the betterment of our world, to the renewal of our world, so that life can actually flourish. Your takeaway today is this. This is the point I want to drive home today. Your work is holy and part of God's plan to heal the world. Your work is actually holy. It's set apart and it's part of God's plan to heal the world. Let's read it in our text. We're actually going to jump around a little bit because I just want to highlight a couple of the key pieces here without reading the entire narrative. But Genesis chapter 1, starting in verse 26, it'll also be up on the screen for you. It says, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Now jump over to chapter 2, starting in verse 5. When no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land. And there was no man to work the ground. And a mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living creature. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Now jump down to verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. In these texts that we just read, we're in chapter 1 and chapter 2, it presents two narratives of the creation of humanity, all represented in the person of Adam and Eve, male and female. And in these narratives, we see that God actually gives humanity a purpose. It's not just creation and they're just skipping and frolicking around with the animals, and right? Like that's kind of like felt board in our kids' classes, and that's a good place to start, that it's perfect, it was wonderful, there was no sin, there was no violence, there was no power struggles, there was none of that. And they're in the garden, and they're, you know, his responsibility was to name all the animals, and that was it. But there we actually see that God gave us a purpose when he created us, and he set us to a task, to work. Chapter 2, verses 5 and 15 says that when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no plant of the field had yet sprung up, and there was no man to work the ground, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to keep it. I want to highlight three things that we could just see very quickly here, just in these two verses. Number one, God created the world. God worked. He went about work. That was part of his nature. He's a creator. Creation is work. And God is a creator. And so it's part of his nature, which would also imply that as people who are made in his image and likeness, we were also created with work as part of our nature. That's the first thing. Number two, God created the world to be worked. When he created it, it wasn't a finished product. It was good, but it was wild. It needed to be worked. It needed to be cultivated. There needed to be fruit that was produced from the land. There were things to do. It wasn't that it was unfinished makes it bad or imperfect. It was just that God intended it to be that way so that we could work and help God make this world flourish and grow, that life would explode. It required work. That's the second thing. The third thing we can see here is that God gave us the world, gave humanity the world to work it and to keep it. It's a gift from God. It's part of what he's given to us. It's part of our relationship with him, is that we set about this work as well. Now, already, just at the very earliest words of the Bible, we're given a very different vision of work than what most of us experience day in and day out. It's this amazing truth that's very countercultural, that work is not a condition of sin or the fall. Work is part of God's good creation. Work was part of God's purpose for our lives, that in working and contributing towards the flourishing of this world, the world itself would be teeming with life and would be blessed. Now, if you've read the whole Genesis account before, if you know the story well, you've probably gotten to chapter 3 where you see Adam and Eve fall into sin, and then God has some things to say about what happened. And this is what's going to happen because of your sin. You've probably read that. And God has a lot to say, actually, that hard work has really seems to be the product of sin. But let's read what God's saying here in Genesis chapter 3. To Adam, God said, "Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you. You shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground." You want to eat, you got to work hard. You're going to sweat. You're going to get cut and muddy and bruised. It's going to, and what comes from the ground, you'll get some wheat and you can make bread from that. But guess what? You're going to get thorns, thistles, you're going to get weeds. You have to do hard labor. The ground is not going to yield the same fruit and harvest for you that it once did. At the fall, when Adam and Eve sinned and sin came into the world, God declared the curse that mankind would experience. The land was not going to yield its harvest or blessing in the same way. It was going to take hard labor. They were still to be about work. The part of that purpose that God created us with to contribute to the flourishing of this world, that to the cultivating of this world, that life would come and spring forth from this world, that didn't change. You would still work this world for your life and for the life of all that. Like, that's still something that's going to happen. But you've made it incredibly harder on yourselves because of what you've done. Now, this is prophetic language. This is poetic writing here. And there's a difference that we've highlighted over the past 2 weeks between forthtelling and foretelling. Very quickly, foretelling is predicting the future. And that's what most of us think when we think of prophecy. But actually, most of biblical prophecy is forthtelling, which is God giving his perspective on the status of the world and on the spiritual condition of humanity. It's God giving his perspective, and there's a lot of symbolism and figurative stuff in it. But God's words here, they can seem harsh if we don't understand that this is prophetic and poetic. It can seem harsh. It can seem like God is saying, "How dare you?" And he starts dropping the hammer to crush them and brutalize them and make them suffer for what they've done. But God's not doing that. What God is actually doing is saying, because you've done this, this is what you've brought upon yourself. this is the natural consequences of bringing sin into the world. There was this relationship. There was this co-labor. There was this plan and this purpose that the world would be bursting with life. But now you've gone and introduced sin into the world, and it's twisted creation. It's done something incredibly awful to this world. It's brought a violence into the ground, if it will, and it will not produce the same way that it would before. He's foretelling what sin unleashed has done to the world and humanity from that point on. What's really interesting is that for all of, you know, the theology that we've written over the past thousands of years, including the Jews, not just Christian theology that's been written, but for all the theology that has been created and debated and written, there's tons of things on the nature of sin and on the flesh on the inside of us that tempts us to sin. There's tons of stuff on that, and it's great to understand that. It's very true, but there seems to be very little of those things as part of this conversation God has with Adam. It seems that God's words here in Genesis 3 deal almost exclusively with sin's impact on our work when he's speaking to Adam. And just like how God redeemed everything else in your life through Jesus and his work on the cross to save us and forgive us and to declare us innocent and to wash us clean of our sins and to bring us from spiritual death to life, just like how God wants to redeem everything there, God also wants that redemption to go as far as even touching your work and make it holy work. But how can work become holy? I've worked some rough jobs in my life, okay? Like, I wasn't always a pastor. I did my time doing some other stuff, too. And being a pastor can have its moments, too, okay? Just saying. But, like, I've done a lot of really nasty, gross working jobs, and I'm like, how is this holy at all? And you can think of some of the things. Maybe you're in a role like that right now where you're like, how on earth is this holy? Let's jump back to our text. Chapter 1, verses 26 and 28. God said, let's make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over all the earth. And God blessed them, and he said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. So God gives Adam and Eve, male and female, this mission to subdue the earth and to have dominion over it. Now, to subdue the earth means to bring it into subjection or subjugation. To have dominion over it means to rule over the earth. But this idea of subduing and having dominion, it carries in Hebrew this image with it of treading down wild growth to make a path. Right? So like, if you've ever walked into just a field before, or you've gone hiking or something, you've come upon a place that it has been the path less traveled. Let's put it that way, poetic, right? You come across that path, it's overgrown. And so when you're walking through it, you know, all the high grass and the weeds and everything, they're hitting you from all sides. It's like you're pushing through it. But then there's other paths where it was wild overgrowth, but so many people have come through it that there's a path that's been beaten down, that the weeds and the plants and everything has been crushed underfoot. They have bent to you. You don't get out of their way or go around. Like, that has bent to you. That's this idea of subduing and having dominion. We've been given authority over the earth to rule over it, to make it bend to our will and to produce what we want, to work it, to produce it. That's the idea, and that's a very popular idea of how we like to strip our world of natural resources and use it for what we need and all these great things that we've accomplished in technology. I was standing out in my car this morning while it was heating up, and I saw a plane going by in the sky. I'm like, man, we've done so many great technological things. And I'm looking at my car, and my car is not great, and it's not very eco-friendly, and it's pumping out all sorts of smoke in the early morning. And I'm like, man, look at our great advances in technology and what it's doing, right? And we have become masters of this world. We have figured out how to take the raw materials of the earth and use it to build skyscrapers and produce medications and build vehicles and transport us and fly through the air, like have dominion over the birds of the air, like we can have dominion over them, but we've actually gone into the air and we've taken over the airways and we've done these kind of things. We've made it subdued. We've had dominion over it. But before we think that our purpose of holy work is just domination, Genesis 2:15 balances out our understanding of holy work. 2:15 says, the Lord God took man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. Now, these words are very different from the two we just looked at. To work it means to cultivate it, to serve it. To keep it means to protect, to watch over, to preserve. See, friends, there's also a caring, protective, dare I even say pastoral element to our work, where we're invested in the outcome of our world, where we're invested in the outcome of our community and the well-being of those who are around us, and we're invested in how our work can contribute to the world and bring flourishing in life. Because your work is holy, and it's part of God's plan to heal the world. Now, when our work becomes holy, it begins to till the spiritual ground wherever we are. It starts to create an atmosphere where both spiritual and physical life can flourish. That's really what the abundant life, this everlasting life that Jesus offers to us is. It's not just life in heaven. It's also life here and now, that the kingdom of heaven, that the life of heaven would come here on earth, and there would be a renewal. There would be a healing. There would be a mending of our world. This is what Jesus wants. This everlasting life that we receive both here now and after we die, that allows humanity to flourish. And human flourishing is the end result, the final goal of God's mission to bless all nations. The Christian philosopher Miroslav Volf, he wrote a book called Flourishing. And at the beginning of the book, it says this: human flourishing stands for the life that is lived well. I use the term interchangeably with the good life and life worth living. It evokes the image of a living thing thriving in its proper environment. The good life consists not merely in succeeding in one or another endeavor we undertake, whether small or large, but in living into our human and personal fullness. That, in a word, is flourishing life. So I want to kind of walk through some examples of how we can understand the idea of human flourishing and our holy work and how that plays out in our lives. Holy work that leads to human flourishing looks like giving my best to my workplace. Because when I do that, the company begins to succeed and get healthier and get better. And they start reaching their goals, which then expands the company, it grows the company. And once they're able to do that, then they can give raises. And they can hire more people in, which increases the quality of life to its employees, both in the finances they receive, but also in their workload. And it doesn't just do that, we can make an argument that it also contributes to lowering unemployment that we're seeing all across our world. And when the quality of your work stands out because your work is now holy work that you're giving to the Lord, then all of a sudden you find yourself getting to have God conversations. You're not just a witness in word, but also in action. And that leads to more influence even in your workplace. Holy work that leads to human flourishing looks like when we give our best to our neighborhood. Like when, for example, when we help elderly with storm cleanup, getting rid of their branches or helping them with any of the issues. Or we go out of our way to show just interest and kindness to our neighbors, get to know them, get to know their lives, what they're going through, what their kids are going through, what their parents are going through. That leads to relationships in your neighborhood growing, which leads to trust being built, where they see the life of Jesus in you and they start thinking they're the real deal. They don't just preach it. They're not just one of these people who go on Facebook and repost all these different things. They're actually living out what they say they believe. And then all of a sudden, that leads to the spark of spiritual life beginning to flicker in others. And when that happens, man, they start coming to you. in times of need. When they go through suffering that's inexplainable, they come to you. When they have questions, genuine faith questions, they come to you because they can trust you. They know you care about them. And you have all these opportunities that can lead to the moment where you can introduce them to Jesus. And if that happens, just by giving our best to our neighborhood in our holy work, that can lead to exponential ripple effects in the neighborhood through their holy work, in their family through their holy work, in their job place, and so forth. You can see how this starts having a snowball effect. Holy work that leads to human flourishing looks like when we give our best to our home, where we spend time and resources and the work of our hands creating safe and welcoming spaces where our family is well provided for, and where we can invite other people to come in and to share in our life. That leads to encounters with God through our hospitality, through kindness, and through testimonies that we share around the table. And that leads to deeper community and life-giving relationships. And if you're plugged into a life group and you have deep community here, or you're in a core group at Chi Alpha and you're plugged into that deep community and those life-giving relationships, then you know that authentic community lowers loneliness and depression that we have in our society. A confessional community where you can be honest about your weaknesses and you can confess your sins, and you can, that leads to being strengthened by others to overcome your sin. When we live in a Christ-like community, when we all are striving to walk in the unity of the Spirit and to live like Jesus with one another, then we get a taste, we get a snapshot of what the kingdom on earth as in heaven actually looks like. Lastly, holy work that leads to human flourishing looks like when we give our best to our families. Parents, I want to talk to you for a minute here. When we give our best to our families, our kids can see God's love for us reflected in our marriages. That's when we're giving our best to our families. And when our kids see that, then we get this healthy family where kids can actually grow in the knowledge of God. When they grow in the knowledge of God, and over time, we end up creating a family history with God where we can see and remember and talk about his faithfulness to protect us, to provide for us, to heal us, to be present with us, to lead us, and so forth. And that leads to kids getting the discipleship, getting the education, getting the opportunities that they need to succeed in life. And all of a sudden, they start going further than us. Our ceiling in life becomes their floor, and they start giving their holy work to God to play their part to bless all nations. Our holy work sets in motion this kingdom on earth movement that leads to human flourishing. But just like our discipleship, just like this life that we're living with God, we have to be committed to it. We have to play the long game. We have to understand this is a lifestyle. This is not just, I'm going to wake up and give this a try today. This is an ongoing thing that we have to work because it's cultivating. No one planted a seed, watered it, stood outside and watched it grow immediately into the harvest crop. No one has ever done that. If you had, you'd probably be a billionaire right now, solving world hunger. But that's never happened because that's not how cultivation works. That's not how growth works. That's not how life flourishes. It's a commitment day in, day out to work it, to keep it, to tend to it. All that pastoral stuff, yes, to control it and have authority over it, but to watch over it, to preserve it, to nurture it, and to make sure life comes out of it. It's a lifestyle that we have to live to see holy work lead to human flourishing. And the more of us who follow Jesus, who give our holy work as worship to God, and we give it as part of our participation in God's mission, the greater our impact is going to be on our neighborhoods, in our city, in our schools, in our state, in our country, and in blessing all nations, just right where you are in your life. I'm not telling you to go overseas. I'm telling you, where's the garden that God has placed you, and start working it faithfully. Because your work is holy, and it's part of God's plan to heal the world. Luke, if you could come on up, we're going to bring this to a close. The idea that we can contribute to making the world a better place is not really a new concept. Just ask Michael Jackson, right? Man in the Mirror. If you want to make the world a better place, right? Like, Start with the man in the mirror. Like, this is not new. We all know this. We all understand this. There's been many teachings on it. We know that this is how we get things getting better, is that we all have a part to play. The problem is, without Jesus, anything good that we can contribute to this world is eventually either twisted or robbed by sin and by the flesh. It becomes something corrupt, or becomes something self-serving, or just, it's just robbed of its power, that it's just short-lived and it doesn't outlive us, or maybe it survives for a generation or two, but then it fizzles out and dies. Even when we do great things to change the immediate situation in people's lives, without Jesus, there's a hollowness to it, because more money, more possessions, a better quality of life, that is not necessarily human flourishing. Human flourishing is wholeness. It's living the life worth living. And people can never be made whole without Jesus. We've had so many attempts to fix our world, and they failed miserably. We've talked about it several times in the past, the idea of a utopian society through socialism. That's just led to the collapse of different societies, because there's been the human factor in it. Political idealism, thinking that this candidate or that candidate or this view or that view, that is going to be the thing that answers our world and our society is going to recover, that's only led to even greater division. Controlling behavior, right? Like, well, if this is all wild, let me just go and subdue it. Let me dominate it. Let's have controlling behavior. Let's bring legalism. Let's have cultural imperialism, where we force our ways onto other people's ways because we think they're superior, that they're better. That's only led to tons of pain and suffering and confusion in our world. Swing to the other end of the spectrum, and there's this idea that wild living, where anything goes, could be the answer, but that has only led to brokenness and emptiness. All of these wrongly teach that the answer to the deadness and meaninglessness that can so often be present in our daily lives, these all wrongly teach that more wealth, more education, greater freedom and control is the answer. That the answer is having the right information, or picking the right side, or just having a better worldview than the one you currently have. Now, while the best of these things may be helpful and may improve someone's immediate situation, they don't lead to wholeness. But holy work through sons and daughters of God who play their part where they are in cultivating the garden they've been given by God, that can lead to human flourishing. That can start healing our world and really making a difference. This is a very different way of looking at your work, right? Showing up, bagging groceries, showing up, doing administrative work, showing up, answering the phone and phone calls, showing up and working on the line in a factory and doing different things, overseeing a team of unmotivated people. Like, this is a very different way of looking at our work. But this is what God's created us for. This is the potential. This is what could actually be there. You can make your work holy. What does this mean for all of us practically? Because it's good to cast big vision and to philosophize. We tend to do that a lot, talk about this big picture, but where does that come down to our daily life? How do we live this out? I want to give you five ways real quick, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. Five ways you can start making your work holy tomorrow. You can do it today, but tomorrow's the work day. Number one, see the bigger picture behind your work and how it contributes to this idea of human flourishing. For some people, your workplace, man, that can be real easy. You know, if you are instilling water wells in countries that don't have access to clean water, that's a real easy way to look. I'm contributing to human flourishing. But if you're flipping burgers at McDonald's, or at Burger King, right? Like if you're flipping burgers, that's a little more difficult. How do I see this? How do I figure this out? But what you got to do is you have to figure out how to start connecting your work to the big picture and connect the dots all along the way and take the right attitude to get to that big picture. Maybe what that means is you serve your boss and your coworkers as if you're serving Jesus. If there's a job to be done, you jump and do it. If you're seeing issues and things going on in the personal lives of your coworkers and your boss that's affecting their work, maybe you can actually be the person to encourage them and to speak life into them. You know, you're not flipping burgers. You're actually feeding the hungry, and your kindness and love can actually encourage and uplift the customers who come to you. Maybe you could talk to your manager and you can plan something special. You could ask, we want to do something special to give back to our community and to bless the people who are really in need. You know, maybe that's something that you can actually do, but maybe that requires the company has got to do a little bit better than what it's doing right now. And so what you do is you rally everyone to work hard and make the company succeed. But if it takes that work, do it. That's how you look differently at the work of your hands. Don't just flip a burger. Look at how you can change lives through that. Number two, be intentional about making the money and the resources that you worked for start working for you. See every single resource in your hand that God has provided to you through the work of your hands. See them all as both a gift from God and a tool from God. Not as your master, not as something you're putting in the grind day in, day out just to try to get that better sense of life or this better. Not to do that. Don't enslave yourself to that daily grind just to make money, just to pursue a means to an end. Make your money and your resources and everything that you have because of the work of your hands, make that work for you and to be a resource for helping to contribute to human flourishing in our world. Number three, prioritize making the work of your hands have a lasting effect. Don't settle for allowing your work to become mindless and insignificant. Bring purpose to it. Sometimes it's as easy as just connecting the dots. Other times you got to really go through an attitude shift, or maybe you've experienced a lot of pain and hardship at your work and you got to work through some offense and healing, but you got to put the work in so that your work doesn't become mindless and insignificant. You got to figure out how to make it purposeful. You got to figure out how to make it have a lasting effect. Don't just do menial jobs. Steward your time so that the work of your hands is not just going to insignificant things, that you're actually doing things that have a purpose, that can create a difference, you know, in your world. Don't just waste time on meaningless things. Which leads me to number four. Practice finding God in even the most insignificant of tasks. Sometimes you just can't get out of those meaningless things. It's just part of the job, right? Like, sometimes mopping a floor is just mopping a floor, and that's it. Like, nobody's around, you're by yourself, you're just doing it because it's scummy and it needs to be done, and that's just what you do. But invite God into that space. Allow him to speak to you through your work. I'll never forget, I worked with a pastor at one of our churches. He wasn't the lead pastor. He was like the pastoral care pastor. But a lot of times those guys, they also get given the facilities and the care of the facilities. This guy was a gifted preacher. This guy was super fun. He was great at leading others and discipling others and building teams and just he had so much more potential than the roles that he was actually entrusted with. And I remember him, you know, having these conversations with him, like, don't you ever get tired of having to do this? Like, don't you want to do more than just this? And he told me a story about how one of the toilets overflowed just because it was running water. So it was clean water, but it flowed out into one of our bathrooms. And he was going to mop it up, and he just started seeing the water spread and come closer and get into every crevice and every crack. And even in that, he invited God into that space, and he felt the Holy Spirit speak to him about how God's refreshing water can come and how it can invade our lives and saturate us and spread to everyone, and it can't be stopped. Like, you can put sandbags in the way, but somehow water is going to find its way and creep its way through. Just the line of communication with God just kept going on and on from there. And it's taking something that is menial and insignificant in finding God in that space. And you can practice the presence of God like that so much in your life that when other people do see you wash dishes or mop floors or flip burgers or whatever else we do, data entry, whatever else you think is just insignificant, when you do it as unto the Lord and Jesus steps in with you and you're spending time with him and you're doing that one meaningless role with excellence, there people can sense God with you in that moment. Why do you care so much about it? What is going on? Why do you bring so much that you're so joyful in this? I hate this role. This is the worst job here in the company. Why do you do that? People can sense it and see it, and that has an impact. That has a change. Lastly, number five, know that your identity is not in your work. You're a child of God first, who is dearly loved by God, and he's proud of you no matter what you think you've accomplished or have not accomplished in life. But you're not defined by what you do, by the work of your hands. It's part of your creation, but it's not the totality of your creation. So what you do does not define your worth or your value, and especially not your identity. For example, you are not an employee at Cook here in town who happens to be a Christian. No, you're actually a child of God who happens to be an employee at Cook. Understand your identity is not tied to the work of your hands. Your value is not tied to these works that you may think are just meaningless and dead. And so it's good to have dreams. It's good to have aspirations. It's good to have ambition to grow and to advance and to move further, but with the right motivations that my work is holy no matter where I am in life, and it's going to contribute in any way I can make it to human flourishing. So what does your garden look like? How have you been working it? Have you allowed God into your work to subdue the chaos and to serve and protect the world around you that you've been cultivating? Have you allowed God into your work to cultivate the world around you so that life and other people can flourish? I don't know about you, but I want to make sure that my work is not something that I approach as obligatory, something that feels draining or insignificant in my life. My life is too short to have dreary work, to have draining work, to do things just because I'm obligated to do them because they're insignificant. My life has more value, my life has more worth, and my life is way too short to let that be my mindset and my approach to the work of my hands. Instead, let's make our work holy. Let's make it set apart and given to God as an act of worship. And as we say yes to his mission, let us really start living this thing that Jesus called the abundant life. And you're going to find that as you practice making your work holy and approaching it this way, you're going to find that you're actually training yourself for God's mission in every area of your life. It's a training ground. It's a way for us to submit to the work of God in our lives, where he can move through us, work through us, bring life to others through us. You can do all these things if we just commit ourselves to making our work holy, because your work is holy. It's part of God's plan to heal the world. Would you stand with me? I want to pray for you here today. Would you just put your hand on your heart? We're just going to give God our work in this moment before we let you go. Father, we come before you right now. God, we give you the work of our hands. God, we invite you into those workplaces, into those places that are boring and mundane and can be seemingly insignificant, the things that can just seem obligatory or just like going through the motions, just another job, just another thing to do, just another day. God, we invite you into all those places, and we ask you to make those sacred spaces in our lives. We pray that the work of our hands would be holy, set apart to you, and that even the most small and seemingly meaningless thing, the most menial of tasks, that God, that those things would contribute, start contributing to human flourishing in this world, that we would see the big picture and we'd be able to connect what we do to what you're doing through us, that we would be, even if it's just being faithful where we are, God, we pray that you would take our work and you would redeem it, that you would use it for your glory, God, that other people would see how we work, see our commitment to serving you in our work, God, and they would see that and it would impact them, it would affect them deeply, God, that they wouldn't even know why it's doing it to them, God, but there's something stirring on the inside of them because of how we choose to work, and not just in our workplaces, God, but in everything else we do, God, in the chores, in the laundry, in the raising raising of our kids, God, in working with our neighbors and helping them and serving them and going out of our way to walk with kindness and interest in their lives, God, inviting people to come along, doing the cooking and cleaning the house, to have people over, God, even if it's a sacrifice, even when we're tired, God, that we do it because we want to contribute to human flourishing. God, I pray that you would help us see the big picture and that our work would no longer be dreary, that it wouldn't be obligatory. God, that we would fight through the negative emotions. We'd fight through the tension of emotions that we feel when it comes to the work of our hands. And we would fight through it, that we would offer it up to you as worship, God, and that it would truly be a sacrifice that pleases you and helps cultivate life in this world around us. God, we love you. We give it to you, and we bless your name. God, in the words of Psalm 90, let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands. Make it endure. God, we pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, I hope you guys wake up tomorrow a little bit different, seeing life a little bit differently. We love you guys. Thank you for being here. Volunteers, we're going to be back there just a little bit. And you guys can hang out and enjoy each other and have a wonderful week. God bless.